athletes, hands up. Do you all have your coaches here? No? Okay, who does have their coach here? Okay, give those pieces of paper to your coach. Did somebody write something for their coach who's not also their father? No? Okay. When you come home, give this to your coaches and tell them, I would like to do this. Do you ever do that? Do you tell your coaches, this is what I would like to do? Do you do that? No. Yeah. A coach who's going to accept what they get on a piece of paper from their athlete is a good coach or a bad coach? He's a very, very good coach. And being a good coach in the period of growing up means taking into account what the athletes would like to do. It means talking to them. It means discussing things, and it means being good in communication. And when you're good in communication, you can accept their wishes, even if you don't agree with them completely. What if somebody wrote to you, I would like to have 10 minutes to structure by myself in each practice? What would you do with this? So coaches are used to planning the whole practice, right? You have an hour and 30 minutes. You will schedule every 90 minutes. So we will know what you'll be doing every time. And an athlete comes and says, I would like to have 10 minutes to structure by myself. I will do stuff connected to table tennis, but I would like to decide what I'll be doing. What will you do that with? Will you take that and put it into practice or not? Yes. Will you do that every time? No. Because then you'll only have an hour and 20 minutes of practice that you can control. But if you do that every now and then, if you have that on Tuesdays and Fridays, it's enough, right? Building a compromise is one of the key communication skills of every coach. Coaches like to think that they're bosses. A coach is a boss. The athletes depend on you. Would you agree, athletes? Do you need your coaches? Yes, you do. Because when you come to a competition, who's going to tell you where you're going to sleep? Who's going to take you from the airport to the hotel? Who's going to tell you when to get up, when the practice is? It's the coach's job. So they are bosses. However, they are allowed to take suggestions from you, and coaches, you should take suggestions from athletes. Because what's happening when they're growing up? They're becoming much more able to decide for themselves. A 12-year-old child cannot decide for themselves regarding how their practice should be. If you ask a 12-year-old what they would like to play, they would like to compete, they would like to have fun. A 15-year-old, a 16-year-old needs to do more drills. And they need to be there if they want to be successful when they're 20 years old. But just paying attention to the drills will make practice boring. And they would like to keep having fun, because the important thing is that having fun is what kept them going in table tennis. Table tennis is a rich sport or a poor sport, from the perspective of how much you can earn. Poor, of course, right? How many of you are going to make $2 million per year by playing table tennis? Have the football players in major leagues get at least as much, right? There's not that much money in table tennis. And there's no, I want to be rich and that's why I want to play table tennis. No, you play table tennis and you keep playing table tennis because you like it. And you stay in table tennis because you're enjoying yourselves. So when you grow up, you know that you're not going to make that much money off of it. But if it's kept you going from 6 or 7 when you started up until 15, so that's almost 10 years, why couldn't it keep you for 10 more years? So you've been having fun for 10 years or 8 years. why not have fun for 8 more and then get you to 20, 25 to top level table tennis? And coaches, if you think that becoming an adult athlete or growing up as an athlete is just about becoming more serious, more focused, more into the sport, perhaps you're making a mistake. And coaches, hands up. What did you write on your pieces of paper? How many of you did this in the past 2 or 3 practices that you held? Did you? Yes. Yes. How many of you have stuff on their pieces of paper that you haven't done in a long, long time? What is one of the biggest problems for coaches? It's burnout. Burnout comes from doing a lot of stuff with little rest, with little pay, and with little enjoyment. If you start adding things that you like into your practices, if you enjoy watching them do what they like, why not do that for yourselves? And when you're having fun in practices, when you're smiling, when you're laughing, they're going to be doing the same thing. Because we're going to start a little bit of a discussion on communication. The nonverbal communication is based on relationships. You know that people who've been living together for a long time start to behave similarly, right? People and their dogs look alike. Have you seen those pictures? Yeah? When we're with somebody that we like, we start behaving similarly. And when somebody we like smiles and laughs and has a good time, we are going to have a good time because we're connected to this person. So a coach who comes in with a face like this every time is not going to create enjoyment in their athletes. It's going to create resentment. It's going to create dullness, boredom, anger. But you need to have fun in order to be good. I think we've agreed on that. One more thing. At which age does fun become less important than results on a competition? Yeah? Never?
Maybe when it becomes a player's occupation and they need to make a living, their responsibilities.
Mm-hmm. I lecture for a living. I'm a university professor. That's basically the main part of what I do. And I'm having fun today. You know why? Because for the past week I've been thinking of what can I do that I've never done before or I haven't done in a long, long time. I haven't given a lecture without slides in a long, long time. I know that when I'm having fun lecturing, it's going to be a fairly okay lecture. Not necessarily the best one anyone's ever heard, but it's going to be an okay lecture. And I'm doing this for a living. Right? I need to pay my bills. I need to pay my hugely overexpensive phone. I need to have money. Everybody does. And I'm trying to have fun while I'm doing it. Why should top sport be any different? We're currently at the Faculty of Sport. We're involved in a project called the Athletic Project. And it's basically about dual career. So how to get athletes to get an education as well so they can have a job once they're completed with their athletic career. One of the main parts that we see in athletes when they finish their careers is that they take jobs that they find boring. They used to have fun doing sports. They would travel, they would learn new stuff, they would meet people. And they would be doing this on a top level. They would build a huge database of memories for themselves. They would build their esteem, their self-confidence, and so on. Once they finish their career and go to a desk job from 8 till 4 p.m., they're not having fun. But they would do sports for a living before as well. Becoming a professional athlete in the terms of living by sport or making enough money from sport to be able to support myself, I don't think that's the best reason for me to start focusing on results. Because if I've been focusing on progress, on doing better so far, that's what I need to keep doing. Otherwise, it will change. Because I get a paycheck, what changes in my task? Nothing. I still have 10 practices a week. I still have competitions. I still have training camps. So basically my job stays the same. Now I just, by some lucky coincidence, can get paid for it. So that is not the best or the perhaps the perfect answer, right? You said never. Why never? Why should we never focus just on winning?
You should have fun, no matter what you do.
Yes.
In life. If you're not having fun, then you're not leaving.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter who you play sport or you...
Or lecturing or being a coach.
Enjoy it and do the garden or whatever.
Yes.
You have to enjoy it.
Okay. I would agree with you. Would anybody say that there's a time when we need to start focusing on victory? When and why?
Because I was world champion when I was 22.
Yes.
And from my experience, it's good to have fun, but if you don't get results at any moment, you will be unsatisfied, and your interest and your fun and your desire to play table tennis will decrease.
Mm-hmm.
You must have results. Mm-hmm. One way and another way. When you have results, you want to have more results.
Mm-hmm.
So it pushes you in the positive way to go up. If you practice hard and you get only defeats or unsatisfying results, then you go down. And then the negative comes, other negative things, and so on. So it's a reason why we have to keep fun to play table tennis.
Yeah.
I still like to play table tennis myself, even if I don't play competition anymore. But at that time, and before, when I was 15, I started, I was 11, without results, I can tell you that I would have probably do another
finished, thing. Yes.
I wanted to be dancer,
okay,
ballet dancer. But at one moment, I got results in table tennis, and I said, okay, I will continue, because it's good, I am satisfied. And so without results, no way.
But are we talking about the same thing?
I don't know.
Yeah. I think that perhaps we're not. What happens a lot of times is that people just start to focus on results and say, now fun is not important anymore. And what you said is basically the perfect answer to my question. You need to have fun all the time. And the more fun you will have, the better you will be. And eventually, the better you are, the more successful you will also be in competitions. Because if I was to ask you, when we were doing the calculations or when you were coloring the pattern, how many of you would continue? If I now said, now at 12:10, I have two workshops. One is for improving your math skills, and the other one is for coloring beautiful patterns. How many of you would take the math workshop? Okay, we have. There's always a few people who like math, okay? How many of you would take the coloring workshop?
I.
Yes, right?
Because I didn't have time to finish.
With the math, right? Or with the, there you go.
I wanted to create a wonderful picture with different colors.
There you go. Yes, and you had fun doing it, right? There was more to do. Yes.
I wanted to finish it.
Yeah, and when there's not enough time to do something, so when you haven't had enough time to practice for one competition, and you just come into the quarterfinals, but you want more, you will practice more, because it's, I want some more. And you said, you need to have fun. Yes, of course. And from fun come also results. It is true that without results, the fun will decrease as well.
Sure.
Yes.
But what about if we say that the results are part of the fun?
Always.
We are ready to,
of course.
You know, to, let's say, to sacrifice and work hard. But it's part of the fun, no?
It's two different fun. Like, there's a fun just to have fun and go and play stupid things.
Yeah.
There's also, I think, the top athletes, like the top golfers in the world, their fun is to be in the hardest, toughest competition.
Yes.
To play, to play on the playoff hall at the Masters.
Yeah.
That's fun.
We're
that's
not, best, yeah, yeah, of course. We're not discussing the type of fun where you would bring Legos to practice or where you would bring books for your athletes to read and practice, or where you would give them 10 minutes to play video games. No. But we're talking about fun of doing something that you like. If somebody of the athletes would write, I want 10 minutes to structure by myself in practice, of course they mean to do something connected to table tennis, to do a drill they like, to perhaps play a few points, to play games about table tennis. It's not fun sitting down and, I don't know, check if my nails are clean or play a video game or check Facebook postings. No, we're talking about fun connected to the activity that you're doing. It's not playtime fun. It's not children's fun. It's athletic fun, which means doing, they wouldn't be here if they didn't have fun connected to table tennis. So I would go with your answer. Never stop having fun. But I would add this part that you said. Having fun will bring results, and results will enhance the fun. Because it's fun to see that you're doing good, isn't it?
Yep.
Yes. And of course, when you're matching how much time you need to spend for playing sports on a high level, or when you're 15 years old, right? You need to adapt your lives to sport, don't you?
Yep.
Yes, you have less time for school. You have less time for friends. You need to give up weekends, vacations to practice. Right? It's a sacrifice. You wouldn't be doing that unless you were having fun with it. This is your type of play, basically.
No. It's not a sacrifice because you like to do it. It's a sacrifice if you talk to other people who doesn't practice any sport and you tell them, oh, I don't go to cinema, I don't watch TV, I have no time, I just practice and I have school to do and so on. For them, it seems to them that it is a sacrifice.
Yeah, that's what
but
I'm saying.
For us, it's not a sacrifice.
No, it's a choice because they've been doing this for a long time.
Like
yeah.
For us, it's not a sacrifice. I don't regret that I didn't go to cinema with my friends
when I
was 15.
No, I'm saying from the general perspective, they give it up, they sacrifice that.
For
yeah.
us, it's not a sacrifice.
Of course, they wouldn't be doing it if it was if they saw it as something difficult. They would stop sooner or later.
Enjoying the process.
Yes, of playing table tennis. Yes. Okay.